What's billed as my talk tonight is puncturing myths about pyramids, planets, and the Bible. And I'll paraphrase that to another way, how good a scientist are you? And now I'm going to get into that, but also to pick up on a slightly different theme just before I get to my own topic here, Bob and I had the privilege, or put it more precisely, I had the privilege of joining Bob on a recent invitational expedition to Ethiopia. We just got back. Everybody's been asking me about it, so I thought I would just insert a few minutes here of a little bit of the Ark of the Covenant. Now, many of you probably have heard that some people believe the Ethiopians believe that they have the Ark of the Covenant, and many people have dismissed that, me included, originally, because of they believe they got it in the days of Solomon. You can demonstrate from the scripture that the Ark of the Covenant was still around in Hezekiah and Josiah and so forth. So the belief that they cling to has some problems. But what almost everybody has overlooked is the possibility, in fact, the high probability, that the Ark is in Ethiopia by a path that everyone's overlooked that's in the scripture. And we have, those of you that have seen our briefing pack called The Seat of Mercy, we cover that background, but just to give you a quick profile here, when Manasseh, as you may recall, very evil king, blood from border to border, he destroyed all copies of the Torah, he put up idols in the temple, in the Holy of Holies, and made a real mess of things. So the Levites, whose mission was to protect the Ark, apparently removed it, not just from the temple, but out of the city and out of the country, to keep it out of reach of Manasseh, to protect it. Now, when he's succeeded by Josiah, his people stumble on a copy of the Torah that Manasseh hadn't destroyed, and in reading it, Josiah realizes how far they've fallen, and it initiates a whole revival. It prepares to have a major Passover celebration and so forth. And in 2 Chronicles 35, verse 3, Josiah requests the Levites to bring it back to Israel and put it in the Holy of Holies. And most people studying this are familiar with that passage. What they don't notice is it doesn't say they complied. He just requests it. And what's interesting, a few verses later, Pharaoh Necho takes up arms against the Assyrian Empire. Now, you may recall Assyria ruled that region for several centuries. Is apparently falling apart because it's only a few years, a decade or two, when Nebuchadnezzar and Babylon rise to power. So it's clear that the Assyrian Empire politically is starting to fall apart. And I'm assuming Pharaoh Necho probably went there to cherry pick some assets of some kind. So much for the politics. But the strange part of the passage is Josiah takes up arms against Pharaoh Necho, about verse 20 of that chapter. And so if you look at 2 Chronicles 35, picking up about verse 20, it'll be on the screen. Necho, king of Egypt, came up to fight against Carchemish by the Euphrates, and Josiah went out against him. That itself is very strange because Assyria is the enemy of Josiah as well as Pharaoh Necho. So here's a guy going against the enemy of Israel, and yet Josiah is going against the attacker. In fact, it puzzles Pharaoh Necho. The next verse, it says, but he, that's Pharaoh Necho, sent ambassadors to Josiah, saying, what have I to do with thee, thou king of Judah? I come not against thee this day, but against the house wherewith I have war. For God commanded me to make haste. Forbear thee from meddling with God, who is with me, that he destroy thee not. So Pharaoh Necho was puzzled. Why is Josiah coming against him? But he makes this strange remark. God told him to do this. Now the next verse I'm going to read is not part of the quote from Pharaoh Necho. It's a comment by the chronicler. He says, nevertheless, Josiah would not turn his face from him, but disguised himself that he might fight with him, and hearken not unto the words of Necho. Notice the phrase, from the mouth of God. And he came to fight in the valley of Megiddo. And what happens following, Josiah gets killed in that battle, and they mourn his death and so forth. But this is very strange. The chronicler records in the word of God that Pharaoh Necho somehow got his instructions from the mouth of God. That implies that the Levites not only took the ark down there under his protection, but had set up shop, a tabernacle, and somehow God was communicating to Pharaoh Necho. And that's in the scripture. So apparently, the Levites took the ark from Jerusalem down to Elephantine Island. This time of Pharaoh Necho is also roughly coincident with the record of a relic that's been protected by the Ethiopians since that period of time. And they went down to Elephantine Island. Now, Elephantine Island is about where today the city of Aswan is on the eastern bank. But in the middle of the Nile, there's this island. It was the first dynasty fortress. It was when Egypt was first united, Upper and Lower Egypt, that is. It was clearly in the 25th dynasty, which is the period of Pharaoh Necho here. It had military importance, we know from the records. The Ark apparently remained there from 630 BC to about 430 BC, about two centuries. And when we were there, we visited, just got back, we found evidence that there was a temple to Jehovah that served a Jewish colony, because in the Persian occupations, about a century later, they were able to get mercenaries, Jewish mercenaries, that were still from that colony. So it's a matter of record that they did have some kind of Levitical establishment there. But anyway, after two centuries in Elephantine Island, it comes down further south, upriver, if you will, to Lake Tana. And that's what Bob had talked about in terms of the storm that he encountered one of the times he was there. And Lake Tana is about over 90 kilometers across. And there are many islands, small islands, but one of them is Tana Kirkos Island. And the Ark apparently remained there for about eight centuries. And so we're on the Nile. The fabled Blue Nile is nearby. As we go on the boats, by the way, there are live hippos. Those aren't the kinds that the e-ticket guide will shoot with blanks, you know. They are apparently very dangerous. And we're talking thatched roofs. We're talking, these people are dirt poor, but something very interesting, they're happy people. It's very interesting to observe that. We were, because of Bob's relationship that he's developed over a number of visits to this little colony of monks that are on this island, we were allowed to get on the island. They not only allowed us there and shared some things with us, they actually opened their treasure. You notice this crude hut here on the left. You'll notice the book, the door has all these slide bolts. This is where they're hiding their manuscripts and their implements. They showed us things that apparently date from the days of Solomon that they still venerate there. And so from Tana Kirkos, after being there 8 years, it went to Aksum, and that's where it's still protected to this day, whatever this relic that they're guarding. We could not find anyone in any of these visits at all levels, all the way up to the president of Ethiopia, that has any doubt that they are guarding the Ark of the Covenant. That doesn't mean they have it. It just means they really believe they have it. And now what's interesting, if you study Isaiah 18, the whole chapter, and you study Zephaniah 3:10, it confirms the idea that Ethiopia, when the Messiah comes and rules on Mount Zion, they're going to present to him a special offering. What they don't realize is what the offering really is, because most people think it's the Ark of the Covenant. And it may be, but that's not the relevant part of the offering, surprisingly enough, and I'll come back to that. When you get to Aksum, there is a number of very impressive churches, but there is this strange church. It looks like a military bunker to me. They call St. Mary's Church of Zion, but it's a very protected, gated area. Inside that building, or perhaps more accurately, in tunnels underneath that building, is this relic that they believe is the Ark of the Covenant. There is a full-time guardian who spends his entire life within that compound, never leaves it. And there's a child that when a woman is barren, she goes to the priests for blessing. When she has her first son, that son is given to the church. That cadre of young men is the group from which one is selected. It's their highest honor to be the next guardian. And he will attend the garden, be with the guardian. When the guardian dies, he takes his place and will serve until his death. When again, this has gone on for 2,400 years. And now, once a year at Timcat in January, they bring out, and not the literal ark, but probably ceremonial relics they use for their procession. So everybody says, did you see the ark? No, we did not see the ark. But I can tell you of our expedition of 28 people and all the experiences we had during those 3 weeks, I think I'm not misrepresenting when I say all of us strongly suspect they really do have the ark. But it's not in Ethiopia's interest for the world to understand that. That would just complicate their burden of protection. But anyway, they take this thing through a two-day ceremony. And what shocked us, these people are descendants, they're Levites. They're descendants probably of Moses and his first, the Ethiopian wife. Remember, he had several wives. But here you have